search terms that will lead them to your play. So it actually behooves you to be as specific as possible in both representing yourself and also what your play is about. What will be things that people want to produce? And then the other thing is there's a little bit, I guess it reminds me of sort of social media, where it's that people can read each other's plays, people can comment, people can recommend. I guess it's kind of like liking. So in one version of this, what if, I mean, there are some API writers on there, but what if a whole bunch more joined, started reading each other's stuff, commenting about it, and even if, you know, what if a theater is looking for this? Well, my play might not be right for you, but guess what? I know a great writer who I also met at the conference, and they would be perfect for you. This kind of networking could happen on their infrastructure, which they've already created. The other thing is something that Aguirian, who also works there, talked about, is they'd be more than happy to help us get the word out about things. For instance, if there were to be, for instance, an Asian American equivalent of the Kilroys. You all know what the Kilroys is?
Why don't you explain for people who don't know?
Right. Well, it's partly to address the disparity in gender, right, of plays that can. So it's specifically a list of plays written by women.
No.
Oh, okay, sorry, I thought there was a look. But you could have something of the equivalent, that here's, you know, another underrepresented group. If you have any interest at all, here's a list, and it comes out, you know, every year. And of course, that's something that is very easy for the media to pick up. It's something very easy for NPN itself to sort of post about, or tweet about, or talk about. It's, right, those sort of sound bites. So that's another way to use the existing infrastructure and sort of piggyback on it, and again, help all API writers hopefully get their work out so that they can find the locales. And then some of them might be very unlikely. It might not be the obvious places that decide, you know what, diversity's in the zeitgeist right now. We want to do something, but where do we find the play?
Jeff, do you know the National New Play Network, in its inception, and its original mission statement, was it conceived as an organization or as a model to serve playwrights primarily, to serve also, I mean, like who does it serve?
I think the mission come, and again, I don't want to speak for them, sorry, but it's writers first. They were talking about, you know, development hell and those things, and how do people, you know, who aren't in New York get their work out there. And then, but it's also helping theaters and writers to connect with each other. And that's theaters of all different levels and all different places.
Right, so the folks that I brought alongside me here are directors and producers and writers. And I had them think a little bit about the needs and the challenges that they face in their various capacities. When thinking about new work, when writing a new play, when looking for new stuff. So I was wondering if any of you just want to kind of kickstart the conversation around what it is that you find challenging about what it is that you do.
I know speaking, using my producer's hat, is just trying to find the scripts that fit our mission for our particular group. As we all know, we all have specific missions, for our own organizations. It's not one size fits all for Asian American theaters. For portfolio productions, we look specifically for genre fiction, horror, science fiction, steampunk, pulp noir, the sort of the big, larger in life characters, the literature, the fantastic, what have you. That's very difficult to find, in general. And even more difficult to find it among Asian American authors. I have to know people.
So how do you find this stuff?
I have to go ask people, hey, Prince, do you have your particular script? Let's see, Carla, do you have something that fits in these particular financials? Or we say, hey, Maggie, write us something, please. So I think it'd be a lot easier for us to be able to on our script, if it was out there, there was a little bit of database and a bit of descriptor to say, what's the play about? I mean, it's like, if we were looking at, rows of descriptions of plays, our folks will take a look and say, okay, good. I know what I'm looking at.
Right. Before I move on, I just kind of want to get a feel for the room. So how many of you identify as playwrights? Just so I could get playwrights, directors, producers, actors, dramaturgs, academics. Okay. All right.
Designers.
City managers. Great. All right.
My theater company in Los Angeles specializes in site-specific, responsive work, and so it is challenging to find a play that fits our model similarly.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We have
a
different sort of model, and not just that, putting the play in a specific location illuminates dramaturgically, right? The play is not just a gimmick for the play. So it can be very difficult, and so we do have a writer's group to help develop in the hopes that we can develop work that can be produced by the company, but we're also finding that we're producing work that we still don't feel is right for our company and we want to put in a theater, so we're actually in the midst of trying to figure out if perhaps even our mission statement needs to adjust a little bit to accommodate the kind of work that we do want to be doing, right? Are we limiting ourselves too much?
Right.
And then on the flip side, I feel like as a director, I'm often just the play has already been found, and I'm asked to come in to help shepherd the process.
Mm-hmm. So. All right. Let's hear from Andrew, and then we'll start opening it up to discuss further.
Sure.
Andrew, as a playwright, you have a very unique perspective, I'm sure. As a playwright, you have a very unique perspective, I'm sure.
I guess so. So I'm a member of the NPX, and I think the idea is great. I haven't gotten any work from it yet. But I also could probably be more active on it. So as an Asian American playwright, my work is kind of odd in that not all of my plays have Asian characters in them. And then my plays that do have Asian characters, usually more often than Japanese American characters, because that's what I am, also have. They're also multiracial, right? And that comes from the fact that my family is Japanese, white, black, and Latino. Although looking at me, you wouldn't guess that. And so a play I've been developing this past year is about two Japanese Peruvian siblings, and there's an Afro-Peruvian character, and there's an indigenous Aymara nun, right? And the director has told me, she said, an African-American director, she said, that in and of itself, that cast list is an obstacle to getting produced. Because we don't, in the United States, we view the United States as being the only diverse country. There's this unspoken assumption, right? Which is absolutely not true. My one Japanese American family drama also has one African American character and one Mexican character, right? And so, I'm really interested in cross-racial interactions and dialogues that don't involve Caucasian people. And because I feel like multiculturalism in this country is always Asian white, black white, native white, Latino white, right, etc. And so I feel like I have trouble for those plays in particular. I sometimes have trouble finding homes. And then for the plays I write that don't have Asian characters in them, people think, well, why are you writing this play?
I want to just jump on, but it's exactly for all of those reasons that I, as a producer, have commissioned Andrew. And I found him through a various network of people, asking around, I need this, and then found him. So,
thank you.
Yeah.
There must be a better way.
Yeah.
But let me turn the exact same question on to you all. What are some of the challenges that you face in your various artistic capacities? What needs do you have that you don't see being fulfilled? Does anybody want to continue this conversation?
I mean, specifically in terms of finding plays or.
Yeah, just in the context of new play, before we kind of get deeper into this conversation.
Oh, I think as a
producer. I work.
Why don't you introduce yourself?
Oh, I'm Nicholas. I work with a theater company called RSET Playing Los Angeles. And as a producer, finding plays is hard because we're a smaller company, we're a young company, and we don't necessarily have relationships with a lot of agents who will send us things that we want. So what I find is I have to look for them. And it's hard because, like, the only Asian people who write plays that the world will let us know about are like Julia Cho or whatever. And it's like, but that's not what we do. We're starting to focus more on like who's emerging, who are the people who can benefit from production or reading by a smaller company. But like, how do you find those people? And it's like, when the Killer Race list comes out, I have to like control F and just type in like random Asian names that are like the obvious thing, hoping something comes up, because like that's my best shot, you know? So it's like, how do I do that? Or like how you said, it's like someone said this or whatever. I find for me, I work at Southwest Repertory for my full-time job in the marketing department, and I can go downstairs into the literary department and be like, hey, who are you reading who is Asian that might not be right for this theater because it's a bad theater, but like who could work for me? Or like, what was something weird you liked? So like, I can do that sometimes, but like not everyone has that.
So you think a sort of like a larger Lord theater has more resources?
Yeah,
than you,
yeah.
Even though you've been around for 3, 4, 5 years.
Yeah, and I don't know, and it's also, at least for us on our website, maybe this is something that I can change, but we don't solicit submissions. Maybe, like, hoping that other people can submit to us. Because also, I consider myself a playwright, and I do write, and I do see companies to send plays to. But some companies, it's like, oh, I'd be perfect for you based off of your mission. And maybe you're, like, ethnic or Asian, but it's like, oh, it doesn't look like you want anything from the outside world. Mm-hmm. And it's like, so it's like, oh. Where do I go? So it's like, it's a little thing too.
Right. You know, piggybacking off that, I mean, I was wondering if I could talk to Rick a little bit, just because, you know, this is Rick Shiomi, who ran Theater Move for forever.
20 years.
20 years. but you've seen Theater Move move from a small company to a larger company, right? So I'm wondering if you sort of faced the same challenges when you were a smaller company as you did as you moved forward.
I'd actually like to make several comments in relation to that. But to answer yours, we started in the 1990s, and so I think it was kind of a different time in a way, where the playwrights like Philip and Katanda and David Wong and Villani Houston, there were more a set of prominent writers, and so in some ways we were trying to do that, but at the same time we were trying to develop local playwrights because. So many times, so we gave a lot of opportunities to first-time playwrights, just locally developed, and oftentimes actors who started to get into playwriting kind of thing, or even local community people that started to get into playwriting. So we went that route. So in some ways, similar to you, just cultivating contacts and people locally. But I did want to comment about a couple other things. One is it's interesting because. I am part of a development project funded through the Dorstuk Foundation, Building Demand for the Arts. And the first grant I got through that with Interact Theater in Philadelphia was to develop a kind of Asian American presence and demand for Asian American theater in Philadelphia, which sort of had not really existed there. One of the things we developed was a database of Asian American plays. But in many ways, because Interact is on that New Play Network thing, we actually put a notice there and got a bunch of the plays from there. And so in some ways, it was a duplication of resources. But at the same time, it was meant for the local Philadelphia theater community. And so we really were kind of like specifically pulling those plays and making those plays available to the local Philadelphia theater companies, all of which were non-Asian American in that sense, but sort of beginning to, through our cultivation, beginning to show an interest in Asian American theater. So there was that. But I just want to comment also, though, that the New Play Network, that list or that database is actually not just new plays. It's actually just like all those playwrights have all of their plays on there, so it's not just new plays in that sense, I think. Oftentimes they are newer plays, but you know, because I'm not sure what the agreement is, because sometimes a playwright has an agreement with Semifrench or somebody else so that they can't make those plays available on that database, in a sense.
I believe every writer, you can post as many plays as you want, whether produced
or not produced, okay.
As long as it's specified.
Okay.
Yeah, but you can put as many as you want in descriptions so that people can find you. But it just has to be clear what, you know, would be a world premiere, what wouldn't, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
If you want to be part of the rolling world premiere program, of course that has to be, because that comes with a grant, it's all these theaters. But no, it's not as exclusive to unproduced ones.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then the last comment is with Andrew is that I've known Andrew for a number of years now, not a long time, but several years. And in an odd way, interestingly enough, when I was the artistic director of Mood Performing Arts, his plays were a little bit problematic because where our priority was Asian American, almost purely Asian American, and the sort of access was really Asian American white primarily, in a sense. And so, but I am recently started another company that's actually looking at the larger diversity, which is Latino, African American, Asian American. And so now suddenly, Andrew's work might be of more interest to us. You know, so because of this changing framework of my perspective, which is in fact new for me, is something that where I'm looking for a different type of play, in a sense. So I just wanted to make those comments.
Thank you.
Yeah, Jeffrey.
Hi, I'm Jeffrey. And sort of my comment is based off of, I'm Jeffrey Lam, I'm a playwright director, and I'm also on the artistic staff at TheaterWorks in the South Bay Area. And sort of, I guess, in sort of responding to what you were saying, Prince, in terms of different challenges that many of us, or at least I, approach, and I want to look at those of us, which I think is most of us that wear so many different hats, where I think that's where something like the Kilroys and what those wonderful women have done, that's what makes that so powerful, because it's a way for us to sort of self-select and elevate the work that we're doing as a group. Because of the fact that we're wearing so many hats, it becomes a little difficult. Like from my personal perspective, you know, I'll see an amazing play, Asian American play, and I'll mention it at season selection at TheaterWorks. And it's great because more often than not, there's gonna be a play that I found that ends up on the main stage season. And I feel great because that's an Asian American person on the Lord stage. But there's also the aspect of, oh, I could have directed that somewhere else.
Right.
Which is a little disappointing because I'm not at the point where I'm directing at the company that I work for full time. Also, I try and represent myself as a playwright, but then I'm someone who's at TheaterWorks, so every other playwright's like, hey, can you show them my play to the people over there? And I'm like, well, I want to show them my play. I don't even show them my own play. you know what I mean? So it's an interesting dichotomy where you know, we, because of the fact that, you know, a lot of what we're talking about here at this conference, that Asian American theater and Asian American theater companies as organizations are relatively new, so many of us are still wearing so many hats. Like Nicholas saying, you know, he works at the marketing department at South Coast Rep and he also runs a theater company. And so it's sort of hard where it's like you have to both represent yourself in certain creative forms, and also we're trying to make it so we have representation at the larger theaters, but it does sort of, this might not be the right word, but it's sort of detrimental to your personal art in some ways because of the fact that you can't always vouch for yourself or advocate for yourself as a personal artist without being that person. Like, oh, they just want to talk about the stuff that they're doing as opposed to actually thinking about the organization as a whole. I sort of want to look at a way to help elevate each other while still allowing us to wear each other's hats. I think that's where we have to look out and read each other's work or look at the other stuff that we're doing, so that way we don't have to put ourselves in those positions and we don't have to like say, you know what, I'm just only gonna run my small theater company and now I'm gonna work at a restaurant, you know? which some of us do and that's great, but I think that, like, you know, coming from my perspective, that's sort of a challenge that I don't know how to exactly approach.
Right.
A way to elevate yourself.
Right. That's a great point, trying to navigate all those different roles. Do a lot of people find that you're facing sort of what Jeffrey is exactly talking about?
Yeah, because I was actually going to say the exact same thing. You literally took the words out of my mouth. you know, I on the side, I run a small Asian American theater company, mostly to give opportunities.
Oh, this is Kathy.
I'm sorry,
Kathy from Seattle.
Mostly to give opportunities to local Asian American artists. And lots of times when we're looking for new work, I travel everywhere to go look at shows and do a lot of Google searches and have partnerships with a lot of larger organizations and get their leftover scripts. We'll produce a lot of playwrights' first plays, like Lauren Yee's first play, Michael Glonko's first play. I always look at Theater Moose seasons, and all these ones are after they produced it. But we do the Northwest premiere or the West Coast premiere. And then now they're pretty big name people. Yeah. So now us trying to, get rights to do their plays, it's interesting. So wearing that hat, it's like talking with Lauren going, I'd love to produce a new play, but then I'm wearing another hat where I'm looking at the larger art sector. I'm also the Culture Partnerships Manager for the Office of Arts and Culture in Seattle. And I also want to support Lauren as a playwright, knowing like, and this is the conversation I have with her and a lot of other playwrights that we develop, like Michael, where I'll actually say, I would love to produce it under my moniker Sis Productions, but if I can help you get it at the rep or some of the larger theaters, I want to help you do that because that creates greater visibility for this playwright and opportunities for our artists to work on those stages. But then I'm having this conundrum within myself, but then do I really want to elevate those theaters by giving our best artists over there? But at the same time, I know for their careers, that's a game changer. So it is a huge struggle I have daily in trying to wear both my hats and honor the legitimacy of both.
I also wonder if I don't know if this is totally changing the point, but there's the thought of, by nature of sort of what Jeff, you and I were talking about outside of this, the inherent structure of the way new play development happens in the country, without anyone saying it out loud, we're basically competing with each other. All the playwrights in this room, we're competing with each other. We're all at the O'Neill. It's very, like, maybe they'll have more than one Asian American playwright in the O'Neill as a whole, but it's very rare you'll have more than one of us within one of the weeks. We're all sort of competing for a spot, so I wonder if it helps us if we have, again, self-selecting ourselves, a festival where it's an Asian American play festival, sort of like what we're doing here. We have the readings here, but it's something where it's presented and the rest of the country, they are looking for plays. They want to find these plays, and it's like if we can help them and be like, hey, like we're like the grad school of Asian American theaters. Like we're the gatekeepers here. Take a look at these people every year. Here's the people that you should take a look at.
Is that not the idea of what this festival, the festival part of this contest, is supposed to be?
I do think so, but at the same time, it's not only but a predominantly, most of us are Asian Americans at this conference, right? So I think that in sort of like what we were talking about, where it's twofold, where it's we want to be able to share our work with each other and be able to produce our own work, but at the same time, I think it's important that we try and make ourselves part of just theater in general. So I think that there's not going to be a lot of just more predominantly white theaters coming to watch the readings that are happening the festival.
Actually,
portion
building
of the
on
festival.
That idea, just made me think of at this festival is great, and I think definitely the pieces that are being shown here. What's been great is OSF has done a really good job in trying to make sure that the audiences are coming to see their main stage shows are coming to see the festival pieces too. So in terms of the audience, I think that's great. But maybe where we should be organizing is the next time there's a TCG conference or the Actors Theater of Louisville, where there is some existing festival structure where we can actually literally pitch a tent right across the street at that same time and be showcasing our work there, right? Because otherwise at these festivals, it does end up kind of being the people who are already part of this consortium, which is great. I love seeing the new work here, but if we want to kind of open it up, we need to look at other places to do this.
Yeah, I want to speak about that because actually what you're saying is what we aimed to do. I don't know if we did it and it's the first time, but there's a couple of different things. So traditionally there's been the conference and then the festival and then they were put together. And that, yes, was
for our community to share the work and to see each other's work, and also to share our work with the audiences in that area. The two things that are different about this one was, A, we partnered with a regional theater, right? So we brought it to OSF, and then this reading series is new. And that was actually modeled off of, again, the Latinx community's Carnival, where they had a conference, and then they had 3 days of reading. Because the thing that we hear from literary managers and all those folks is they go to festivals. They want to go someplace where they can, in a concentrated capacity, see that. So that is, I mean, if you come for the next 3 days, you can see up to like 15 Asian American works in 3 days. So we tried to do that. What I don't think we were successful at is broaching the larger community. We hoped that using OSF as a structure would help, but what's happening is we're bringing people and they're seeing a lot of the OSF shows, and they're not seeing our work. So I think that's the next step we have to do. And I like Kathy's idea. I think it's also hard when you're already at TCG, it's packed. So I think what we have to do is we have to put a stake and say, this is us, this, you know, and all of the plays that we are presenting here are gonna be packaged and set, you know what I mean? And they're of all, they were programmed broadly in terms of size, in terms of scale, in terms of all that. So no regional theater artist could ever, you know, artist director say, I don't know any Asian plays, or no one's writing plays for my level of theater, whatever that means, or whatever. So we can do that. And then what Latino, Latinx community did with Carnival was they also committed all of those shows would get production. I think going in, 70% of them had committed to productions for the reading, and they now since have all, I think almost 100%. And so that's the other thing that they charged their community with, and that we are doing also with these readings. I think at least three of them coming in have productions committed already, and we're hoping the other two will also. So I think, but we can't all do it, like we need each other's help, and we gotta push, right? So that's what I was telling. I was like, everyone who's coming needs to bring five other lit managers with them from PWIs, you know what I mean? That's the way it's gonna happen. So in terms of, and I think that's what this conversation is. So we would love to hear other models also, right? Like of how we can continue to do that, how we can partner to raise that profile. But I think there's something in having a concentration. Louis travels a lot and sees a ton, right? And it's when you can see a lot in a short period of time that draws, and there's so many festivals now, so you have to find a niche as to how you're drawing people.
For the video record, that was Sneha. Decide. Okay. Do we have something over here?
I have a thought.
Yes.
You know, like thanks. Just building off of what you're saying about where you have like the New Play Network and like all Kilroy's list or whatever, and then what you're saying with like the festival and these readings, and I feel like I don't even know if it's expensive. It literally just came to me, but like an idea of kind of doing like that festival and that list of saying, here's who we are as like producers, artist directors, litter managers, voting and kind of saying, these are the plays that we like this year. And then what if there was a way, because every company mostly does some form of a reading thing, and then building off that like rolling thing, what if we just rolled those plays through our states and our cities, where we as smaller companies do have connections to the larger theaters that we can bring them there. And it seems like that's an easier way to get people to pay attention to us at their level instead of asking people to like fly here. I don't know what that means, but I just thought about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, the thing with the Kilroy, I would put it out here, is if someone is willing to commit to that, I think like, you know, I think when I was a literary manager, I talked a lot about doing that. And then it takes, you know, that Kilroy's list, it looks easy, but it takes so much time and effort and energy. So we either have to find funding to do it, or someone has to almost full time, you know what I mean, commit to leading that mantle, and we support. But it's a bandwidth thing. I mean, that's what we keep talking about. So we have to either collectively say we're each gonna do, you know what I mean, because you know, we're happy to do that. I'm willing to commit East West Players to help to create, give a platform and visibility to that. But we need support. We need someone to create the surveys and to do the outreach and to read the scripts and to contact the playwrights and to get the bios and to create the website. So I think we just have to. That's what we have to think about. And yeah, someone has to take a charge. Playwrights.
So my name's Jenna Rogers. I'm with Chromatic Theater. I also worked with Fujian Theater in the past. I'm up in Canada. Fujian, a few months ago, launched the 49 list, which was 49 plays by women of color, completely modeled off the Kilroy's list, and we're in talks with Gwydion to try and connect to the NPN network just so that our playwrights have profiles. But some of our playwrights, these women of color, have been like, we don't want profiles on this American network. And like that's an interesting conversation, but I can talk to anyone who's interested in the models of how we did that. We had 5 readers, for example, who were all women of color, and David Yee, who's the artistic director of Fujin, kind of got us all to do it, and he just said he just paid us all a flat fee, and it took us a year. And we probably read a few hundred plays. But from our work in the industry, we were, especially the 2 senior people who, like senior artists, had already seen versions of those plays. So having them kind of captain the work took a lot of the load off in that, you know, we were trying to cross-read and make sure at least 3 of the 5 jurors had read everything. But to have 2 senior members of the community who had already been exposed to a lot of the work actually helped with that substantially. I'm happy to talk a little bit more about that, if that's interesting. But I'm also just like kind of ruminating on new plays and networking. And one of the things that I found really useful in Ontario, so we have 3 levels of funding, federal, provincial, municipal. And in Ontario, at the provincial level, they have this thing called the Theatre Creators Reserve. And from about 2000 to 2014, we had an equity-specific fund that was put out nationally to try and increase work by diverse artists in Canada. And then it closed in 2014 because equity was achieved. there's more changes. There's more changes happening at the funding level, but it was sort of a 2-3 year gap where we were like, what the hell are we supposed to do now? But one of the positive things that came out of that is that Ontario has an infrastructure called the Theatre Creators Reserve, in which what they do is they offer, and I think this is maybe kind of like re-granting, but I don't understand what re-granting is, so I might be really wrong. But they, you as a company would write to the provincial arts body about why your community deserves creative support, and you would be given a small pocket of money, say like $10,000, that you could grant in micro grants to your community. And so that's how we started to build an infrastructure for playwrights. It was that the larger funder acknowledged that the company could be responsible for finding creators who could represent their community. So that meant as like an Asian Canadian theater company, Fujin was able to give out like X amount of dollars a year to playwrights for play development. So you could write a 2-page pitch to us and we could say, that's great, here's $2,000, hope it covers some rent. Happy writing. And that's it. It's like no strings attached, but it also lets us keep tabs on a couple of projects that are going on, which helps us know what's going to happen later. And I don't know if that's useful, but I have always found that program really one of the best ones I've ever seen.
Just want to take a moment. Can we clarify sort of the model of the Kilroys and how they function? So if Jeff or Jennifer Snail, there's not like a reading committee that's actually put together, right? This is just a group of
literary managers, artistic directors throughout the country who
are
nominated or submit to be readers.
Well, it's an ad hoc group of women who then reach out to their network and contact literary managers and other folks who would be in touch with the community and ask them to name plays written by women that they have identified as being excellent that may not be right for their theater, but have made an impression on them. And then the repeat hits that they get
tell.
Yeah.
And those people have to read like X amount of scripts a year in order to qualify to be a reader. So like they are usually like the very top people who are nominating those people.
Okay.
Oh,
we
had
a comment over here.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure where they get
that. Oh, and who are you?
Nancy Wong from Bethnotech.
Right.
My first play was produced by the Asian American Theater Workshop in San Francisco in the early 80s. And I directed it. And then in 87, we were lucky to become, somehow we accidentally became storytellers. And from that point on, we've always then written our own material. We perform our own material. We have over 100 pieces of, you know, that we perform of folk tales and mythology and Asian American pieces as well, anywhere from 5 minutes to over an hour. But we've always performed it ourselves. So now I'm getting old, and I don't know how do I get my work out anyway now and let someone else do it. So that's my biggest challenge right now. But on the other hand, because we've always been able to perform and do our own work and write and became part of the storytelling circuit, we've always been able to perform our stuff. And not in an Asian community, but in the general, mostly white community. So they have a conference, they have a network. So I know CAATA has a network, but they have it so all year, it's all the time. They only produce their workshop, their conference every other year as well. They have a festival afterwards or during. And it seems to work so that in between, there's this, what you were all talking about, how you could continue to be somehow a conduit for membership and provide the kind of context you're talking about in a newsletter. I mean, I don't know because I'm brand new to CAATA, but so I don't know if there are models out there where they really support their communities.
Right.
So if anyone wants to talk about or ask about the storytelling network organization, they're doing a pretty good job of supporting. They're probably about 1,500 national storytellers that work all year round around the world.
Thank you. Does anybody else want to chime in about challenges or other models? Yes.
So my name is Alex Haslett. I'm a producer with Theater Diaspora in Portland. I'm also a playwright on my own. I only recently finished my first full-length play, and it's still not to the point where I feel comfortable sending that to everybody, but I'm also a member of a very loosely knit playwriting collective in Portland called PDX Playwrights. And I'm not sure, by show of hands, anybody here familiar with Fertile Ground Festival? Okay, a couple of you. So Fertile Ground Festival is a festival of new works that happens every January in Portland, and it's citywide. Almost all the theaters get involved. There are a lot of art studios as well that convert their space into small black box stages. And so PDX Playwrights, this group that I'm also a part of, they will reserve this space called Hip Bone Studios for about a week and a half, and everybody who has brought in a play to PDX Playwrights for workshopping, we meet bi-monthly. Has the option of co-producing a stage reading of their play there. And it strikes me that if we're looking to do kind of a centralized location with a festival of new works, maybe a co-production model might be a good way of doing it as well, as opposed to just being juried and selected that way. But I thought I'd bring that up.
Thank you. I also think we should look at outside. So I think like Netflix is great for like how you get lost in that little like rabbit hole of, if you like this, you'll like these five things, and then you click on that, and there's like, so that, I think if we interlace our work and connect it, that is also helpful, because it can be overwhelming just to have a pile of scripts and things like that, but it's helpful to know, oh, I really loved Prince's comedy here, and now I can read Jennifer Chang's comedy, and I can read I'm wondering how we can utilize new technology to both connect our work to each other, but also to get those recommendations kind of rolling with all that.
I wonder if this could be an off idea, but the documentation of readings, how much that helps. You know?
What do you mean the documentation?
Or like video documentation of readings.
Or I think podcasts, if we were, it's sometimes hard to get rights for video, but
or you link to other people's pages. You link to other people's pages, and that is much simpler for your own.
So this is actually an idea that actually I've been kind of playing with, talking to Marvin from Collaboration, because they've been producing a number of podcasts that are kind of making it out through their networks. There are collaborations which kind of mostly focus on the music industry throughout the country. But seeing if there is interest or ways that we could do kind of podcast readings. And initially I was kind of thinking in terms of more of, classic canon, because this is always something that I'm very interested in, is like, how many, next generation new Asian American artists have never gotten to see a production of End of the Social Dance or Fresh Off the Boat or, any of these, any of Alina's work or whatnot. And in terms of, you know, both kind of unifying our movement, you know, it's like, I mean, you can go back and go, okay, you know, August Wilson, right? Or you know, Teatro de Campesinos, right? And that legacy kind of feeds into, you know, who is the next thing we want, right? So that's something I'm also interested in terms of, okay, can we document, can we podcast and just have these available? And it's, and then if it's for new playwrights too, it's suddenly, you know, okay, now I've heard a staged reading of She Kills Monsters and Queen Wynn's, you know, Viet Gone is opening up in New York right now, right? And I can go and buy Asian Chi, you know, and it opens up this whole, you know, leveraging the whole kind of digital revolution and the mass audience that you can access from that. Of course, the question is, how do you convince agents and managers, you know, to let that happen?
You know, there's also a lot of playwrights who don't have agents or managers.
Yeah.
Who could really benefit from that and would let you just do it. Mm-hmm. And I think if we are talking new plays and you want to do a podcast like that, if you focus it on new plays, like, it'd be like so beneficial to a lot of people who otherwise wouldn't get anything.
And also potentially reach a whole new audience.
Yeah.
Yes.
Very engaged with the podcast and YouTube and whatnot, but is relatively theater illiterate.
Yeah. And you know, like another thing we're recently like recommending them for ourselves up, connecting back to what you said with the new play exchange, is like if we're reading things, we should recommend our works on that page if we're there, because like there's a feature to recommend a play, because if someone's looking for a play and they read a blurb, but they're also reading 10 other blurbs, like which one do they choose? And if there's a recommendation underneath their play that has like Snail saying, oh, this play was good because of this and whatnot, it's gonna like help the favor go on to your side because someone recommended it. So I think like if we are reading and we wanna help lift ourselves up and you're on there, we should recommend each other and our works.
Again, at the storytelling conference, we are now going to be working with, Andy, who is Trade Winds in Kansas City. So it's a way of getting the Asian, because the storytelling network wants to diversify more. They want their conferences to have more diversity. So we're working with Andy to bring them into the conference somehow. Somehow we're going to make it more Asian. And so there's always the when you partner with an organization, that you actually create a mutual benefit. So like I know you were with OSF and you had hoped for more of the general public to come to the step, but it hasn't worked as much as you wanted, right? Is that what you said?
I think snails.
Yeah. So there's somehow that there's a different kind of contract you have to have that really supports that the general public comes more to this, and for us, it's having our general public go become more involved with the Asian theater world.
Yeah, I mean, you can also look at the other thing that is the fast class track.
The gym membership thing where you can go to, you buy a pass and you can go to multiple gyms to go to classes at that. And I'm wondering if we need to start banding, in cities where possible, start banding together as theaters, particularly of color, and say for, you know, $10 a month or for $50, you now have membership to all the theaters of color and you can hit each, you know, a show at each one each month or something like that. So that we're collectively raising our visibility and notice, you know what I mean? Or it's like an airlines thing, you know what I mean? And it's I love this theater, and if this is in league with it, then I trust, you know what I mean? But I think, again, it's how can we connect to each other more and help each other's work and support and lift it is the way to go.
I'm going to say that last year in Seattle, a bunch of theaters of color did a thing called Spice Box Passport.
What was it called?
Spicebox Passport, and basically we listed all the productions with a cast of 50% more of people of color, and said that you get a discount to going to these if you get a code word from the productions. If you bought a ticket to one, you get a discount to the others. I'm not sure how well it worked, as far as ticket sales is concerned, because I think that it's sold to people who are already interested. On the other hand, we certainly got a lot of interest from people outside. So it's like they might have just said, I don't care about the discount, but I do have a list of shows I can see now. So putting that out there.
I also want to sort of piggybacking off this idea, sort of, I don't know, an idea came up to me. What if it was one of those things where there was a network of theaters locally that, I don't know, identified themselves as let's say theaters of color, and all of them, all of their subscribers, they created like one universal pass, right? Where all of their subscribers, they got one pass in addition to it, and it said, here's a list of theaters, you get one pair of comps to see one show at any of these theaters, just to sort of expand if these are people that are already clearly interested in a certain type of theater, and it sort of encourages them to go somewhere else, and then maybe you get a new subscriber at another theater, or you get at least single ticket sales at another theater. But yeah, sort of just it's just an expansion of the idea that you guys already brought out. Yeah.
We had a comment over here.
From a while ago. No, it's just picking up on Snail's. I'm sorry, Michael Bateman from A Noise Within in LA. Picking up on Snehal's idea about leveraging technology to look at the idea of this, of having a place where you can go and look at many different scripts makes me think of the LinkedIn model where if you read a bunch of plays, you can say, I really like that one, and then it does build up, builds up like 20, 30, 50 people liked that play or tagged it in that way, means that you have people vouching for you, on that site, help you navigate it.
Also, I just want to bring up that idea of commissioning. I know there's a lot of problems with commissioning and a lot of, but at the same time, I think it's there are many different ways of doing it, and I think the regranding is one system. When I was at MOOC, we had a similar system of starting out with small amounts to several people, and then selecting from that the development of the next sort of. Maybe we gave small amounts to four different artists, and then of those two of them, we then moved on looking at that, and then we ended up producing one of them kind of thing. So there's different models for that kind of commissioning, I think, that can be very useful. And certainly, I'm not sure what the playwright gets out of the rolling premiere other than the productions. Do they get a commissioning fee out of that, or is it just that the producing companies get a certain stipend? Because I know that the companies get a certain stipend.
If you're a bunch of theaters qualify for the rolling premiere program, it is granted money and it's split. It goes to the production and the writer. I can't remember the exact percentages or something like that, but it benefits both if you're part of that.
I think, right? At least that was a few years ago, it was $21,000 that was split evenly amongst
Usually three
theaters, at least two of which have to be NPN partners.
Right.
And I think at least one has to be a core partner. I don't think there's a playwright commission for the FIFA.
But they just get the royalties.
Yeah, for each of the productions.
Okay.
Great. Anybody else want to chime in that we haven't heard from? You have something additional?
Well, I can wait for someone else.
Well, why don't you go?
Okay. Yeah. Well, just a couple ideas about, going back to the idea of this. After the world premiere, so I've been participating for the last couple of years in a national study sponsored primarily by the Theater Development Fund in New York called Triple Play, and playwrights interview audience members to get ideas about their views and opinions about new work. And in general, there's not much of a distinction amongst most theater-going audiences as to what a new play is. And they definitely don't care about the title or the term world premiere. That is more for foundations.
Yep.
And some of them even have even said that some audience members say, well, I don't want to see a play its very first production. They want it to be battlefield tested, right? But in terms of the critical second, third productions, Playwrights Realm, which is a theater in New York, has what they do, they support the second productions of their plays that they premiere by trying to find a theater that will do the second production, and they give some money to support the second production of the play that they premiered. And then the National Performance Network, their commissioning program, the Creation Fund, grantees can qualify for something called the Fourth Fund, I believe that's what it's called, which is some money to then support a subsequent production of the commissioned work once it's created. And then when I was at Cutting Ball, I was extremely blessed to be full-time resident playwright. And you know, commissioning is like all playwrights dream of commissions, probably more often, especially when we're earlier in careers. But then, how many commissions actually get produced? Mm-hmm. I think all playwrights would agree that a production, a commitment to production with a commission is an ideal situation, along with the development process with one primary development partner. And you know, just with Cutting Ball, I was Rob Miller, as artistic director, committed to producing my play Mount Misery about Donald Rumsfeld and Frederick Douglass before I'd even written a word of it. And so I didn't have to search and go from director to director and institution to institution. And I'm wondering to what extent that development, commissioning to production, could be something that at least in this community could be advocated or practiced.
Yeah, that comes with its own challenges too, right?
I'm sure.
And I may have missed this first part, but commissioning is there's only very few theaters in this country that have the funding and resources, and they're predominantly white institutions, right? Most of that money that goes towards commissioning that comes from other places, none of our theaters are getting that money, right? When we commission, we're commissioning out of our theater's pockets. So like there's a number of funds out there, but we either don't get those monies or we're traditionally excluded. So if you look, and OSF is a primary, it's a great example of a commissioning program, and they've gotten a lot of money, but the foundations have made it that we can't get access to those funds. So that is, I think, is a problem, because I will say that when we commission, when Rick's Theater commissions, and when we commission all that, we're commissioning and we're producing, because we can only commission once, right? We commission one player a year, so you're gonna bet that we're gonna, you know what I mean? And so that is one thing that we do, I will say, for almost every CAATA member theater, every theater of color, every Asian American theater, because we can commission so few times and we have to fight so hard to get that money, that we do produce it, or we'll work for it or put it in the pipeline. So that is something I think we're proud of, but I think there is a huge barrier to theaters that make basically $2 million and less in access to funds towards commissioning. So that's a huge structural inequity that we have to, because I think, look at Viet Gong, look at these amazing plays. You know what I mean? And then what's happening is we've often given those playwrights their first break, and now I love Lauren, but we can't afford her, or King of the East, you know, is at the KDT versus, you know. So I think that's, and it's great that they are finding that, but that is a structural inequity that we have to start speaking out against, because of the way those programs are, because then they're also then just commissioning playwrights that they, you know what I mean, that they know and things like that, so, yeah.
I have a question. So, when you've already written the play and it's already been produced, because you produced it yourself or someone else produced it, does it help to workshop it somewhere? And does that then help you get known? You know, where you can do a writing retreat at some place where you get to read it with other people, and or you workshop it somewhere. Would that help get your work out?
I think that most development programs and workshop programs are for brand new plays. So I don't know of a model like that, where plays that have already been produced go on to some other kind of workshop for development.
Well, because there's always rewrites.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, you'll find very often, like, playwrights will be very careful about how they allow the theaters to build their play, right? I mean, at La Jolla Playhouse, we would have a new play development program, and we actually, what would we call it? What was the program called? Basically, the La Jolla Playhouse would do these workshops of new plays, and the idea was that the press was not invited, so that it
you couldn't say it was a world premiere. But these were basically fully produced.
The workshop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The
workshop production.
They had a goofy buzzword name too. Okay. But they would do like a couple of these every year.
Page to Stage.
Page to Stage, thank you. There it was. See, fancy buzzword. So they wouldn't invite critics. They would take, you know, audience input, and they would actually do basically a month-long run, like a full run, but the rewrite process, like, it's like tech never ended. If you were running a room, it was horrible.
And the challenge with a lot of, well, not all of them, some of those programs got to the point where a lot of large institutions, you know, who have a lot of resources, it was their diversity initiative where they get a lot of large foundation funded to support these programs, and they could show, and anyone said, oh, you're not diverse enough. Well, here, we've got, like, we're developing these playwrights over here, but the percentage of those playwrights ever reaching full production that got full support was, I don't know the stats, but it was minuscule. It was, you know, 1-2%, if that. So it became like this thing, like if you got developed there, then it was never gonna ever get produced anywhere else or get a full production or a world premiere. So it was a very challenging thing, and then you kind of get isolated just into that route of all Asian American plays are workshopped to death in some cases everywhere, and the number of full productions is not there.
Yeah, I mean, I think, there were the programs like the CTG lab,
Mark Taper,
none of them ever saw production at Mark Taper. However, all of the artists that got to work there suddenly had these great credits, and they were able to use that to launch themselves for other things, right?
I want to make sure that we leave enough time to make things happen, because oftentimes we get into these conversations and we just talk and talk and talk, and then we go home and do whatever we do. Why don't we just start talking about how we might start making some of this happen? Don't worry, we're not gonna like entrap you into like doing stuff that you're too busy to do.
I think that's okay. Entrap people.
Okay, I'll Asian guilt.
It's on tape, everyone.
I would be ready.
I know everybody's busy, and we're at full capacity. But why don't we just talk? Like, if we had somebody out there, not necessarily in here, but out there, we had all the time in the world to help out on whatever it is that we wanted to do. Out of all the things that we've been talking about, I know that all of this stuff takes a lot of work, but out of all that stuff relatively, what to you sounds like stuff that is a good starting point where it's like, oh, that seems relatively in the realm of all the stuff that we've been talking about. It's relatively easier to kind of get that off the ground and launch. And then I want to talk about how we might go about doing that. So does anybody want to start? Yeah, Andrew.
Well, just building off of what Snail said about how it's hard for organizations under $2 million budget size to get those grants specifically for commissioning. That suggests the need for a conversation with the arts philanthropic community that's a clear need that probably wouldn't be that too hard to fill given if certain decisions were made in foundations.
About having more access to that money.
Yeah.
Because if you're basing it on budget size, you're automatically biased toward, you know, primarily white institutions.
Yeah. Or commissioning programs for theaters of color.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah. Probably. If there isn't much thing correct way of saying it. Yes.
I also suggest that CAATA is actually perfectly set up to carry out that concept in a way that CAATA already is a national network. Mm-hmm. That CAATA already does these festivals and conferences, that if they could get some commissioning funding as a part of this event even, so that playwrights who get readings here then get some kind of commissioning or to develop their plays or encourage the theater companies that are connected to CAATA or that are part of the network already to encourage them
to offer some funding to them to produce, so that, you know, rather than trying to invent another organization, yet another organization, which we don't want to do, right? I feel like CAATA is in the perfect position now that I'm not on the board anymore. I feel like it's in a really good position because they've established over the last 10 years, basically a track record of being able to do this national.
Yeah.
I changed my mind. I have to think it through more.
Okay. I think that's a great idea. Yeah.
Hi, Deep Tran, American Theater Magazine. I don't usually speak, but I feel like I should probably give. Because American Theater is about to run an article about the Soul Project, that initiative from an independent group of Latino theater artists, and they've partnered with 12 off-Broadway theaters to commit to commissioning and producing world premieres of new Latinx works. And then they're planning on partnering with organizations around the country to do second, third productions of those works. And so something that high profile can get you the attention of places like The Times and American Theater. And they've already gotten buy-in from quite a number of theaters because of that profile.
But these are not necessarily theaters of color,
they're off-Broadway theaters, not all theaters of color.
Okay.
Some are, some aren't.
Thank you.
Oh, and Lin-Manuel Miranda gave them money.
And do they have plans for doing the same thing with the Asian
theater? No, they're all Latinx artists, and so they're focused on creating a Latinx new play canon.
Yeah.
I think what also might be helpful is some sort of mentorship system that maybe CAATA could even help facilitate, because I've been developing a play with a playwright who's not AAPI, but this person of color. But I've been noticing a very similar pattern with the way her play development is going that I've experienced with other, you know, AAPI members, et cetera, that just navigating that field of workshops versus working towards a world premiere versus, you know, and who to contact and who to call, because she's not at a stage yet. I mean, she's probably there where she needs an agent, but she hasn't, you know, gotten there yet. So I feel like that, navigating that minefield and playing, you know, and knowing where else to apply for, you know.
So you're talking specifically about sort of like the business side of playwriting mentoring.
Well, I mean, especially if we're talking about how do you find these plays, also being able to be in touch with the right people so that your play can be found.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know that with some of our, you know, local writing groups, it's like there's always a big question: how do you do the business end of things, and how do you write an artistic statement? How do you, you know, submit? Or who do you really want to submit to?
Right.
Yeah.
I wonder if there's a sort of piggybacking off that, sort of like with the Cherry Lane's playwriting mentorship program. There's like an AAPI focused version of that, where emerging AAPI playwrights get paired with established to mid-career AAPI playwrights and or an organization, and they just do workshops and they sort of elevate each other that way.
Your EWP scholarships sort of like that, right?
Yeah, we have scholarships to take our writing courses, which I've been readings and workshops, and then we have a mentor that's also plugged in, who reads the scripts and talks to playwrights, and so David Henry Wong is one of ours. And then we try to do a playwright in residence. I mean, the other things that we're not talking about is how hard it is, how the transactional nature of the business for artists these days, so that you're only as good as your last play, you work 8 years on a play and you get a production, and that's, you know what I mean? So I think sustainability for our artists is another larger question, right? How can we give them money just to live and to eat so they can do their work? The other thing that came up in the Beyond Orientalism thing is for us to also think outside the box, so that a lot of these things are great models,
but they're either reactionary or they're taking up other traditions, which is great, right? I think Latino Commons and the Latinx movement has found something. It's happened to something in the last 3 years. But what is something we can do that's separate and unique that also is reflective of our aesthetic and form, right? So what are things that are, you know, these are bad examples, but like, should we do readings where everyone, these are bad examples, but just telling you, but like that everyone has to take off their shoes before they come into our readings, you know what I mean? Or is it a storytelling tradition? And instead of doing this, we just, you know what I mean? How can we let the art form or structures inform these movements? You know what I mean? So that it's all cohesive and it's reflective of what our Asian American aesthetic is, what that means, as broad as it is. There's been a lot of talk about an app. Like, no one has really quite have gone to the app development world. So that's something that Randy over there has been pulled into. But you know what I mean? Structure equals form, or form equals structure, or something like that, in storytelling. So if we can kind of look at that also.
As we continue to talk in this last 15 minutes, I'm gonna pass around a sheet of paper where you can put down your name and email address. And we're not necessarily gonna ask you to be a part of to do anything. Just give us your information.
And why do you want to?
But let's be in touch about this, right? So okay, let's go on.
Also, this might be a bad idea, but also something that just popped in my head. I was thinking about, you know, that collection that comes out every, like the great short American stories or something like that, American short stories. I wonder if that's sort of a thing where, although not a perfect model, it's something where, you know, if we identify certain API playwrights and have them, and we have someone who's a curator to pick, say, 8 short plays, and that's something where we have different API theaters or theaters of color around the country that commit to presenting that at their theater. That's sort of that's something that I don't think has been done before.
Food is a thing. Sorry, making food.
Ericton said make dumplings while we do stuff.
It's sort of similar in the Beyond Orientalism forum. Somebody had talked about the idea of Kilroy's type list, because that's really helped boost the visibility of playwrights and their shows, and maybe it is something similar. And then also there was an idea that did come out of the Latinx forums that at a conference or something, it's my understanding that everybody was given a thumb drive of 50 plays. So you have access, everybody has access to look at all these plays and recommend them and et cetera. So.
Source this to the Philippines.
I've heard a lot of, you know, of thinking about performing advisory boards and, you know, that sort of thing, and saying, hey, who do we talk? Who can I talk to about this topic? So,
like an advisory committee type of thing.
It'd be interesting if there's more of an investment into the writers. You know, like I think it was in one of the plenaries we were saying, we have no choice, yellow faces, to invest in our own voices and writers, but like, kind of like, you know, like there's the Mayu's Writers Lab, you know, they're doing great work and all that work goes everywhere else, but like in our communities, like do we have something like that? Like for our writers, where we can like give them a safe space that's like free, like not like, oh, I'm gonna pay to take this class and now I'm broke, you know? Like do we have places like that where we're giving them that safe space where they can work together and then work off each other the same way you're saying, like the mentorship kind of thing. And where should I submit? And they have those people to go to. I wonder if that's a way to start like very easy and like ground level, you know?
We have a writer's group. You don't have to pay to be a part of it. It doesn't necessarily have to be site specific. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you just have to know somebody who's in it, who can name you, mm-hmm. somebody whose personality would gel with.
I know for me, like in Los Angeles, Like, I got into, like, the white writers group, and I was like, that's weird. You know what I mean? I was like, where's, like, the one who, or, like, the people who are, like, me? You know? I was like, it was just something that came up, and I was like, oh. I never thought that happened.
Cool. For ideas?
I think that, like, universities are sometimes, like, an underutilized way to get your work out there. Whether it's through anthologies or a thumb drive, allowing your play to be taught can go a long way for students because they tend to recall the things they're taught in university and tend to go produce it in the real world. And in terms of amplifying volume, universities have such incredible power that's often forgotten and underestimated. And I think, like, if you're looking at doing an annual anthology of eight plays or something like that, it's the universities that's where it needs to go. Because, you know, and it might not be cast with all Asians, but the two Asians who remember doing that are going to be like, oh shit, and they're going to buy that book, and they're going to hold it, and they're going to use it when they need audition material and when they go on to direct and produce. Universities are so important.
I'll just tag on that too. So then how can we better reach the academia community? Granted, we're competing with the academia panel.
Right now.
But as a group, right? I mean, in terms of permeating, I mean, even if it's just starting with ethnic studies, I mean, you know, ethnic studies doesn't even necessarily engage with the theater departments, right?
Right.
I mean, theater departments rarely have Asian Americans on faculty either, right?
Yeah.
So how do we engage with those, either of those departments?
Do people know about booking conferences? Yeah? Because that's also a place you can always go to if you apply, you have a booth and you can present yourself, and if you're lucky you get to be on stage to do maybe 7 minutes of your work, and then all these presenters are there to say, oh, I'd like you to come to my theater or my school or my library, or, and there are, you know, many throughout the country.
And there's other conferences. Sorry. Go ahead.
Oh, no, it's okay, go ahead.
No, it was saying there's other conferences and things. Like, I don't know, I know that LMDA this year was like painfully white and they were so embarrassed about it and they were like, how do we fix this? And I go, and half of them are scholars, you know? I feel like if two people showed up and were like, we got plays, people would be so happy.
Did you say LMDA?
Yeah.
Oh, so I'm Lily Tuncrystal. I'm with Ferocious Lotus Theater Company in San Francisco. I think for us, because we're new theater company, and we've been around for 6 years now, but really producing regularly the last few years, it would be helpful for us to have a group, even like an email group, with the other leaders of Asian American theater companies throughout the country, because we're sort of producing, I'm realizing in the last few years, we've been producing in sort of our Bay Area bubble. Like, you know, we did Chris Chen, we premiered Chris Chen's Mutt, but then we premiered J.C. Lee's Crane, but we didn't really talk to anybody else and tell anybody else in the other Asian American theater communities, theaters in the country that we were doing this. And so now I've met people here, which is great, like Kathy and Andy and Snehal. So it would be helpful to have that communication open so that we can share the work that we're doing, and even if it's just one email saying, oh, this year we're deciding, you know,
maybe
like this coming year we're doing, what's that?
Oh, well, yes, let me see, before I had the website, I ran a national email listserv.
For Asian American theater.
For Asian American theater. It's sort of fallen disuse as of late because, I think people like, this. I've moved to Facebook and all that, but
I think I'm on that listserv. It's a larger listserv, right? Of like a lot of different. I mean,
it's sort of downsized in the last few years, yeah.
Oh,
but
okay.
If people want to, pick that up again and do more substantive discussion over the group.
Or do we think that since email is kind of
cumbersome?
Do we want to set up a version of that on Facebook? Where because a lot of other communities of color, how we organize is through Facebook now.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, I, I mean, That's something we can do right now.
Yeah.
And that's very easy to do.
Or could the CAATA, CAATA has a page.
Yeah.
Is that a place?
CAATA just made a group, right? Or?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, you invited me to it.
Yeah.
But
does anyone want to run it?
Well, I mean, but the nature of the secret groups, you don't really need anyone to run it. It's really just it's a private discussion group, more or less. Right?
And then we can invite anyone
to
do it.
And who we want.
You might
want
to create a separate one, though.
We have a CAATA public one. I think we can do it. Yeah, another one.
Okay, yeah.
Like, it'd be great to have this very specific group of
the leaders
of the Asian American Theater Company, so that if I have a question about, we're commissioning this work, and if I have a very specific question about how that would work, or if you're interested in, doing a world premiere with us, like, that could go out to just the leaders, not to the entire, everybody who's involved in CAATA, or everybody who's come to the CAATA conference.
So do I have a job here?
Yes. I'm wondering if we all, until we can get outside support, if we just find a way to each give $10 or something to raise money to fund one artist for a year or a month or 6 months. Like, I'm wondering, some of it is like, it's gonna take other people time to catch up, right? And so we have to kind of do it ourselves. And so, yeah, I just want, can we all just give $10, you know what I mean? And we just try to raise a certain amount, and I think whoever that playwright or director is, that we've given them money that they don't have to work for 1 month or 2 months, they're gonna be more than happy to dive into that work, that, you know what I mean, to tell our stories and to engage with us. So I'm wondering if we just start that somehow,
Kickstarter or something like that.
And we do it ourselves and come up with create our own, obviously come up with an apparatus who gets it, but I think we just need to start, because the number of our artists out there that need support,
you know, it's funny, like, when we first started talking about this idea of a potential Asian American New Play Network, the funny thing that occurred to me is that unofficially that's been happening, right? Like, when Ching Chong Chinaman came out, everyone did it within a 2 year span.
Oh, yeah.
When back in the day when it was Sam I Am,
yeah.
Everybody did Sam I Am. I mean, it is really kind of like, just how do we facilitate this dialogue a little more streamlined?
Backing up what you guys said about the conferences where you present and if you want to do it, you do it. I feel like, we are at a conference right now, maybe this is not something you can do, or maybe it is, but it's really easy, or sometime the next time. But if you have an open space and being like, hey, I wrote, here's 10 minutes of something I wrote. All of you guys are looking for something new. Some of you are looking to share your work. What if, because we had an open mic yesterday, what if that was that? For writers and producers to be like, oh, that's a new voice. That 10 minutes makes me want to read more. And I feel like that's something easy because we are all here. And this is the place where it's all bringing us together. So as a simple solution.
Like this morning at the plenary, I was suggesting
maybe
in Seattle we have this event that's a speed dating between directors and playwrights. Maybe it could be here at the next festival between production companies and playwrights.
And that's what
the directors
is supposed to be similar to. I mean, it's a great idea.
And the storytelling festival has regional tellers perform, and then new voices, so that there's always a place for all that. So it's very inclusive.
Great. Well, I want to thank everybody for participating in the conversation today. We have a lot to. We had a lot to talk about. We have a lot to think about. I'm going to try to. My zero free time to organize some of these thoughts and try to make them a little bit cohesive, reach out to everybody, give you an opportunity to directly unsubscribe from whatever it is that I create. But if you want to stay in the loop on this particular conversation, don't hit the unsubscribe button, and maybe you can get involved somehow in one of these or all of these initiatives that we've been talking about. But thank you so much, and we'll see you around the festival, okay? Mm.